Hey everybody, welcome to Princess Friend. I am your host, Princess Friend. Today I'm rocking out my little red Corvette Mei Ling t-shirt. Really, really fun design, comfortable t-shirt. So of course today is the first day of reviews that we're going to have five of them going forward for this week. It's going to be a whole gold experience week from Tuesday to Friday. And thank you for joining me with the very first video that I've been able to use the premiere function on. And I should be over here in the chat chatting with you. And if I'm not, you should tell me about it. If you want to stay in the loop, make sure to hit that subscribe button and ring the bell so you are notified directly whenever we put out a new video. And of course, where else would you start besides the Gold Experience? That was released on September 26, 1995. And we haven't really been counting each album, but this was Prince's 17th album. That is already a ton of music, way more than some artists have released in their entire careers. And this, of course, is like halfway through Prince's career. So many more to come from there. And obviously, there's even more in the vault that will be released later on. But it's just amazing to think this is a 17th album, not accounting extra tracks, B-sides and all of that stuff. When the Gold Experience was released, it sold 500,000 copies. It charted at number 6 on the Billboard Top 200 and number 2 on the top R&B albums. So those are respectable numbers. But guess what? It didn't sell as much as what Warner Brothers wanted and what they had hoped. They were really hoping for something that was gonna knock out of the park, and Prince was kind of fighting them anyway about getting this album out. And they were already reluctant, so they were like, you better sell a ton, and it wasn't as much as they wanted. Of course, this was partially due to the fact that Prince was tainting his own reputation at the time, and he was writing Slave on his face. It was full on Slave era here. And, it kind of hurt the public's opinion of the album and of Prince in general. Critics, however, actually loved the album, and it was heralded for its approach to politics and sex with a harder edge, and people really liked the rock appeal of this album. It also set a new gold standard for Prince friends everywhere. I think it blew a lot of the previous albums out of the water. This is also why when people ask me what my favorite Prince era was, I say my Prince wasn't purple, my Prince was gold. While doing my research, I actually found quite a few references to this is the best album since Sign of the Times, or this is a second Purple Rain, but I believe it's really on its own level. This album also cemented the NPG in infamy. It burned the names Sonny T, Tommy Barbarella, Tommy Hayes, Maite Garcia, and Michael Bland into our brains. Yes, there were other iterations of the band before and after, but I believe that this was the kind of slimmed down, really awesome version of the MPG that Prince was always trying to top. And I think he did in a couple of occasions, honestly. However, I think this set the new standard here with this group of amazing players. It's also interesting to discuss kind of the different iterations that this album had before it was released. There was a version that had Acknowledge Me, Interactive, and Repop Go to Zippa on it, which those were eventually released on Crystal Ball, but they would have been on here. Also, Chaos and Disorder and Right the Wrong were on a later version of it, but Prince pulled those off and ended up making the next album, Chaos and Disorder, which had those two songs on it. And there's so much more to discuss. Anybody who was curious about the keyboard, sound effects, and the login stuff that I have at the beginning of my intro, you'll find that on this album. Prince envisioned a world where you could simply log into the internet and it would make you feel something. Whatever it is you wanted to feel, you could find a way to make you feel that way on the internet. Now, and this was a theme on this album, but also a bunch of albums going forward, obviously until his relationship with the internet started to kind of sour. And you can see more on that in my Prince and the Internet video, which I will link somewhere here. And I really like the NPG Operator tracks that are in between. I think they give a real sense of scope for the album, and they really draw you into the album as a whole, the Gold Experience, right? Anybody can just throw a bunch of songs on a CD and say, hey, there's my new album. But creating kind of a cohesive experience is something that he was really good at. And I have one last gripe before I move on to the actual review. I went to the Amazon description of this album, and it literally says, available again after being deleted for years, originally released in 1995, 12 tracks including Most Beautiful Girl in the World. I can't think of a lazier write-up than that. It's a single sentence and has tons of misspellings in it and doesn't make me want to buy this. I used to do ad copy a long time ago, before I was a writer, I used to write like stupid ad copy. Amazon, please, like, bring me on. I will write the write-ups for these albums, or whoever's in charge of this. I don't know if it's Amazon, I'm just saying. But it really made me kind of angry, because this is like the album for people to really understand what Prince was going for in his slave era, and to disrespect it with such a dumb write-up, oh my god, it just makes me so mad. Okay, I'm done rambling, okay. Let's get to those tracks. So the album opens with a speaker who's Maite, and she says, "Our special presentation will start shortly, but first, a message from our sponsors." Of course, she says it in Spanish. I believe this was actually kind of a slap in the face of Warner Brothers. The first track of this album has the word pussy in it, and there were already a whole bunch of arguments and conflict between Prince and Warner Brothers because of Sexy MF off of the Love Symbol album. This was basically shots fired. Not only am I gonna do this again, and I'm gonna start an album off with a song that has pussy in it, but I'm going to say that it's brought to them by you. Now, of course, the track itself, if you've seen my songs that are not actually about sex, the song is actually about women keeping their sexual urges in check, making sure you go to school, make your own money, don't rely on a man. It's actually a really very positive and uplifting message. It actually has a really great hip-hop beat. It's got a poppin' bass line. Prince raps over it perfectly. The message is on point. It's like a really, really amazing song about rebellion against the status quo and so many things. There's a lot of stuff wrapped up in the song. So the NPG Operator introduces Endorphine Machine as a sample of one of over 500 experiences to choose from. Prince launches into his hardest rock track to date, which also has his most impressive scream on any album ever on it. The keyboards and drums are also added heavily, with Tommy Barbarella and Prince trading keyboard and guitar solos throughout the track, and there's a cowbell in it that is just, makes it perfection.
I got a fever! And the only prescription is more cowbell.
The concept behind the song is similar to the machine in Barbarella, in the movie, where she's hooked up to this sex machine and she wears it out.
Oh, it's sort of nice, isn't it?
Yes, it is nice.
Prince wants to hook his woman up to this machine, show her a new way to experience ecstasy. I think my only real gripe with this song is there's the breakdown in the middle where he says, "You there with a cynical disposition." And it is so hard to say that at the speed necessary to sing it at this song's tempo, because it ends up coming out as, "You there with a cynical disposition." I don't know, it's really hard to say. The song ends with another really huge, like, loud scream, and then the speaker comes in again and says, "Prince is dead. Long live the new power generation." Again in Spanish, and these were things that, like, I don't speak Spanish. It's really hard to know what they're saying, and I want to know. And then it took me a while before I was able to go and get it translated. Then it launches into Shhh. This track continues the rock streak with a massive drum showing from Michael Bland that brings us into a sexy song from Prince called Shhh. It's all about the ways he wants to have sex with his woman, like doing her after school like some homework, which was a weird line for a grown man to sing. However, you might remember that he originally wrote this song for then-teenager Tevin Campbell's second album. And I'll probably be doing a review for that eventually. But as soon as you know that, it makes a lot more sense. Nevertheless, the song is spectacular. It's really sexy. Obviously, Prince's version of this is really, really great.
Now's the time to find a rhyme. It's got a reason and freedom.
is where the song kind of takes a political stance here. We March essentially explains to everyone listening why it is that Black people protest and are trying to push for change. Oh yeah, even if you can't believe it, it was really bad for Black folks even 20 years ago. Go fig. It is simultaneously Prince's message to the current rap scene, saying that you should do more and you should treat women with more respect and help make social progress. I'm honestly a fan of this song, and again, I think it really shows where Prince was in his mid-90s. He was hard, he was topical, and he was ready to throw down when need be. So the previous three tracks were a sampling of the different experiences, but now a brief MPG Operator track introduces us to the beautiful experience, and we get into The Most Beautiful Girl in the World, which Prince hit number 3 with on the top 100 charts. It should be noted that this track is not available in all streaming versions of The Gold Experience due to legal reasons. I did a video about that, you should check that out as well. That will be here. Also, you should see my review of the Most Beautiful Girl in the World maxi single, where I go in depth into this song itself. One thing that I like about this though, is that it's not just the same track. It's not just Most Beautiful Girl in the World again. I almost see this version of it as the artist formerly known as Prince covering a Prince song and putting his own spin on it. I think the ending is way better on this version. And like other tracks on the album, it's slightly more aggressive. I think it's a great compliment to The Gold Experience overall though. So I've had a lot of people asking what Dolphin is about. And if you take it at face value, it's about reincarnation and friendship. But like a lot of his mid-90s songs, honestly, like a lot of his songs in a lot of his career, it's actually about Warner Brothers and the record industry. It's all about the hard work that he puts into his art and his music, only for him to continue to be a slave. And even if he was to come back as a dolphin, they'd tell you how to frickin' swim. It's a song about freedom, which was a huge sticking point for Prince with his record label. It's kind of weird and it's beautiful, which is why it's part of the beautiful experience here on the album. I'm on the set, freaks on the flow. The way about my name is too long to remember. I could tell you now, but we'd be here till next September. And then we're brought to the Now Experience, which previously included songs like Housequake, Sexy MF, and Irresistible Bitch. This takes the softness of the last two songs and throws us right back into Prince's attitude. This track has the second best scream on the album, which goes on for a long time, and if you've seen him perform it live, he has a cup of water and he just keeps kind of going with it. It's a rap track, crazy beat, it's about the record industry, what else? He raps that he's a genius, but that it's actually more to it than that. There's a whole lot of hard work that goes behind being called a genius, and how there's no easy way to fame without someone else owning you and what you create. It is also a song about dancing and having fun though, so don't get lost in the weeds with all the background meaning on this one. This one's just a really, really fun track. Just have fun with it.
Can I see it, baby?
And then this is where the album starts to take a turn, where you're trying to go back to the beautiful experience with the MPG Operator, but Prince invades your ears with 319, a super sexy song about a naughty photo shoot. Think Insatiable from Diamonds and Pearls, but rocking, and it's harder, and it's faster. One of my favorite lines is, you know you're too hot when you play with your hair. And I'm just like, ooh. I think this is probably some of Prince's best innuendo and wordplay that he's ever had in a song, because he mixes some of his more overt lines in the song with really kind of hidden in plain sight sexual references. Shine, cool.
dogs giving hot virgin white. Shine. Lips ain't warm, but our bodies ain't might. Shine. Looks like we're gonna take the long way home tonight.
The operator continues malfunctioning, and then that brings us to a story about a run-in with a stranger that gets kind of sexy. One of the coolest parts of Shy is that it starts off with footsteps, and it just makes you feel like you're in the middle of the night, you know, and you're walking with footsteps. And I really kind of dig that. It kind of melds into the song and becomes part of the song. I also really like that, you know, Prince picked up this hitchhiker and it seemed like something sexy was going to happen, and then it doesn't. I like that it doesn't happen. You know, they talk and then he drops her off and then that's it. And it's just like a cute song. Makes me wonder if it actually kind of happened. It's almost too specific for it to not come from something and just been something that Prince made up. Like, that would be weird if it wasn't actually something. Prince always also has a really unique way of ending his songs, and this one does something cool where it escalates and escalates and escalates with the acoustic guitar to an eventual kind of at the end. Yeah, it's really, really good. One last interesting note, Days of Wild was removed from this album to put Shy on. And I'm actually happy about that because I think Days of Wild in this spot of the album would have been a weird mix. I think it needed to be soft here to jump us into Billy Jack Bitch, which is the next track. And of course, Billy Jack Bitch is a great amalgamation of driving drums, epic horns, some crazy good keyboard work, and Prince attitude like you've never heard. It was a hard one to pin down in terms of meaning when I first listened to the song, until I learned of the terrible things that were being said by a certain journalist by the name of Cheryl Johnson, otherwise known as CJ. Apparently, she had written an open letter about Prince in her paper, which prompted him to clap back with this song. There's a line in the song where it says, "Just see the dictionary, CJ for Billy Jack Bitch." And before I knew the meaning, I was always like, wouldn't that be under B for Billy Jack Bitch? Why would I see J? Why wouldn't I see B? That just sounds stupid. But once you know the backstory, it makes perfect sense. It's CJ is a Billy Jack Bitch. And ooh, there you go. That Prince and his word smithery. Anyway, this is a really good track. And every time I hear it, I can't help but picture Tommy Barbarella flying across the stage with a rope work.
It's a song, but I hate you.
So we're headed to the end of the album, and of course we are introduced to the hate experience and asked, are we sure if we want to continue? But we do. I Hate You is a song about a heartbroken and vengeful Prince who has been cheated on, but can't help but still love his woman. It's vaguely reminiscent of his early 80s tracks in its theme at first, but then it turns into Prince being the aggressor and he makes his woman stand trial for her crimes. He's not a punching bag anymore. It was a single, hit number 12, which isn't bad at all, and it even had a maxi single with some alternate versions, which I will be reviewing this week. It was a breakup song that was directed at Carmen Electra as well, which kind of gives us a little bit more insight into why their relationship didn't work. Great song, evocative lyrics, solid ballad.
Everybody wants to sell what's already been sold. Everybody wants to tell what's already been told. What's the use of money if you ain't gonna break the mold? Even at the center of the fire, there is cold.
And then the whole system starts to go haywire after the hate experience, which ends with the listener going into the gold experience. It's interesting that we weren't in the gold experience until the very final track, even though the whole album is called The Gold Experience, but whatever. Prince sings about doing things differently and sticking with your spirituality. None of that stuff matters. None of the hate or the beauty or the other experiences, none of that stuff matters unless you are true to yourself. It's a power ballad if I've ever heard one. and it has a couple of guitar solos, an epic escalation of tone at the end that really makes an explosion. It was released as a single and only hit number 88, but it remains an epic classic for Prince friends everywhere. A song many say was comparable to Purple Rain, and really raised his game in terms of delivering a powerful and emotional finale for an album. The album ends with, "You are now part of the new power generation, welcome to the dawn." We've heard this before on other albums, but for some reason, like, it feels different on this one. It feels like I really had joined a movement and an experience. And I think that that's because of the rebellious, the energy, the of this album. I mean, for the longest time, whenever somebody would ask me what my favorite album was, Purple Rain, Sign of the Times, was it 1999? No, I'd always say Gold Experience, because this was the hardest Prince had ever been, with an edge that couldn't be discarded, even on the softer songs. Even the softer songs had an edge to them. I'm really into rock, so it hit all of my buttons across the board, and I believe that that's like the fifth or sixth time that I've used the word epic in this review, and that's how epic this is. Hands down, I would give it a 6 out of 5. A truly one of Prince's greatest albums. But what did you think of Prince's The Gold Experience? Let me know down in the comments, and I would love to hear what was your favorite track. What do you think of my review here? Let's have a real discussion down there, because this album was so important to me growing up, and I'm hoping that it was just as important to you all. Also, don't forget to check us out on Twitter and Instagram, where I post different things at different places. We're also doing our Patreon drive for the next month, where I'm hoping to double the number of patrons that I have at patreon.com/princesfriend. Just over the weekend, we got a bunch of new people, so I definitely want to thank Zach Fender, Desiree Jeffries, Nancy Lopez, and Kim Richardson for joining the Patreon and supporting the channel. It is very, very much appreciated to you and to all of the people on our wall of gratitude. And with all of that said, may you live to see the dawn, and I look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Thank you to those of you who actually watch the end of the video things here. On that side are links to the Patreon and to the subscribe. And below me is the latest video that we've done, as well as one that is picked special for you, because you're a special, special snowflake, and we love you. Thanks for sticking around.